time for our welcome and announcements. Did I get everybody's attention? We're happy to have each one here that is here, and of course, we always want more to come.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. It says, in the Bible, anybody within your gates is not supposed to work. Well, I guess just take the gate down, huh? Not really. It just means anybody within your property. So that's a reminder. When they see us resting and going to church, that reminds them that they're putting God first.
Man.
Okay, so much for that, but there is a video at 4:30, and they've been good. I've been seeing most of those. He's got an interesting way about him. I forget his name. Yeah, that Mexican is an evangelist. He does a good job. There's the evening prayer meeting at 6, the Bible study. No food bank this week. And offering next week is for church budget, but the offering today is for Texaco Ministries. And the child says that they're having a, forget what he called it now, a meeting at the conference, and all the preachers have to be there, so our pastor wouldn't be able to speak next week if he wanted to. He has to be there at that meeting.
Don, they're celebrating the 100th anniversary of Texaco Conference.
Okay. That's it. The 100th anniversary. And of course, you know, the conference office has moved 3 times. It started out in Clovis. Clovis, New Mexico. Then it went to Amarillo. And now it's near Albuquerque. They probably won't move again before the Lord comes. We'll continue now with our service.
Thank you, God.
Thank you.
Lord God, thank you for your Son, for your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come here, to gather together, to worship you, to praise you, and give you the glory. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Change
the
page. Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath. I invite you to open your Bibles to the 51st Psalm. The Psalm that David wrote after he was convicted of his sin and needing forgiveness and mercy from God. As we come to church to worship, part of worship is asking forgiveness.
Yeah.
Making things right with God. Being forgiven. Let's read it, starting with verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. I will not ask for a show of hands as to how many need this. You know, and that's why we're here. We're here to be cleansed. We're here for the mercy of God to blot out our transgressions. And thank God He does, and He forgives. That we don't have in ourselves the ability to do what God wants. We need His mercy. We need His forgiveness. And then He wants us to be merciful and forgiving. It's all part of worship. It's all part of living as a Christian day by day. God, every now and then, brings into my contact at the office somebody that I have a chance to witness to discuss the Lord with. And this week was no exception. And I had a very good visit with a young man. Hopefully, he will be here Sunday night for our Bible class.
Amen.
He said he wanted to be. Whether he can remember or other things come in the way, it will not be the last time I see him. He's a regular there from one of the big dealers as he comes in to get merchandise that they need to dress up the lot. So, he's sort of what you call a gopher in the business. He goes and gets this and that needs to be done so that the powers that be don't have to go and do it themselves. But I thank God that He's given opportunities for us to witness. And I want to praise Him for that. It's your turn. We're here to praise God, to thank God for His kindness and His mercy. If you raise your
pray.
chosen from Romans, Romans the 8th chapter. And while you are looking that up, I want to mention about Romans, Sunday night. We have been studying in Romans. This will be our 28th lesson. And we're in chapter 11. And this Sunday night, if you haven't attended, this is one you want to come. Because in this lesson, we are going to study the most controversial text in the book of Romans. You'll want to hear what God's Word has to say about it. We will study it. We will find out what God's Word says about this in detail. 6 o'clock Sunday. What is that most controversial text? The text says all Israel will be saved. You'll find it in the 11th chapter, Romans 26. Our scripture today, Romans the 8th chapter, verse 7. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. I'm anxious to hear Brother Adams use that text in his sermon today. We have several people to remember in prayer. Daniel's not with us. He's been sick. He's been in the hospital. He may be coming home today. May I?
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth is home today because she's still having a lot of pain in her knee, and we want to remember her in our prayer.
And Allah.
Allah's not here because of also pain and dizziness. And we would want to remember
Lewis.
I'm running a blank right there. Thank you. That's when your wife knows what you're thinking. If you've been married that long and she knows what you're thinking, you better keep your thinking good.
Amen.
Because they seem to know what you're thinking. And it's a blessing. Thank God she does. All right. We want to remember those. And we have, Betty's still going to have her procedure. It's been postponed. We want to remember her heart procedure coming up. Is there any other?
Her grandson.
Oh, yes.
Tina's grandson.
Tina's grandson. I didn't hear very clearly. Is he in the hospital now?
Yes, sir.
Not doing very well?
No, he's in
Is he in ICU? Or?
He's in intensive care then.
Yes, sir.
How old is his grandson?
He's 1.5 years.
A year and a half old?
Yes, sir.
It's a rough life for a little baby in this sinful old world.
I'd like to have you include Angel. She fell again yesterday on her left knee again.
Oh, man.
It swelled up real bad. And
all right.
Put in quite a night. But we...
Now, there are everybody that has an unspoken request you want to make to God. Raise your hand. And you make that request to God spoken right now. And we're going to kneel as we pray. Righteous Father, as we come to you on your Sabbath, we thank you that we are together in this church where we can worship unmolested. Freedom, and we pray that that will continue, that we may continue to worship you in freedom, Father, we pray that you will bless our worship today. May your spirit be present, that we will worship you in spirit and in truth, and that we will bring honor and glory to your name. Father, we come today knowing that we are sinners in need of your grace. And Lord, we pray for forgiveness of those sins. We pray that you will forgive and forget. Cleanse us as David wrote in the psalm, as his request, may it be ours. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Oh Lord, we thank you for your mercy. We pray that you will bless us, that we will become merciful to others, that we will be forgiving as you are forgiving. Lord, we pray as we lift up to you those of our number today that are not here. We do not know all of the reasons why some are not, but we do know a few. And Lord, those few we want to present to you. We want you to especially be with Daniel in his illness, that he may have strength again to be able to attend to fellowship. Lord, we pray that you will bless Elizabeth and give her relief and healing in her knee. And Tina's grandchild, that young year and a half old child in the hospital. Lord, we pray. We know you love children. Put your healing hand upon that child. That he may have a good life and bring honor to your name and confound the doctors with his healing. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to bless Lewis and be with today, especially Angel. She will stop this falling and hurting and have better balance. Father, we ask that you will bless Olive and her problems that she's, and they're more normally we know caused by old age, Lord. Many of us are having those problems. As we get older, we get feebler. Father, we pray that Jesus will come soon. We're told in your word that only you know the day and the hour. And Lord, we pray that that is soon. For this is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Today, and it's for Texaco Ministries. They have a little sheet they give me to give you ideas of. Today's offering will help advance ministries in our local conference area. Thank you for sharing the burden so that many can be blessed. That's what it says at the end. Up at the beginning, it says, Americans could give more, but the facts are they have lots of credit cards and things like that. And Mr. Ron Blue, whoever he is, I don't know, but they quote several things from him. I won't read the whole thing. The stewardship part, department in our local conference will help you plan ahead. How can you bless your family and God's work even after you're gone? Deciding that is, you know, is good. That is good stewardship. So anyway, it's for the Texas Texaco Ministries. Father in heaven, we thank you for our church here and help us each one to witness for you the best we can. And we pray that we'll have wisdom in doing that. In Jesus' name.
Father, breathe on us. Allow your Holy Spirit to penetrate our minds. Let our ears be clear and hear a message from heaven. In Jesus' name, his meek and lowly character. We pray this prayer. Amen. Well, every time I've spoken, I've spoken in a parable, and today I want to speak again in another parable. I just want to give you an example to kind of feed off of as we start. I just want you to kind of relax and imagine you're in this situation. Imagine that you live in an apartment complex, and let's say you're on the first floor. And above you is a vicious fight taking place. I mean, they up there moving concrete. It's a brawl. You know some serious fighting is going on. What would you expect to hear? Probably some glass breaking, some profanity, maybe some screams, you know, some loud thuds hitting the ground. Well, this analogy is reminiscent of the spiritual warfare that's taking place in this world. We have light versus darkness. We have holy angels versus unholy angels. Now, just like you can't see what's going on upstairs, we can't see into the spiritual realm. But you can imagine what's going on upstairs, and you can hear what's going on. Just like in this battle of good and evil, when we see someone selfishly rob someone else, steal from someone else, or hurt someone else, that evil angel won that battle. Not the war, but that battle. And the opposite is true. When we see someone living for God, going about their life with self-sacrificing love and service, the holy angels won that battle. Okay? But going back to this example of this fight taking place on the second floor, let me ask you some rhetorical questions. What is your reaction to what's going on? Do you call the cops? Do you turn a blind eye? Do you turn a blind ear? Do you go up there yourself and stop the mayhem? Do you begin to pray? Do you call your friend and gossip about it? Or do you bang on the roof with a broom and tell them to quiet down? You know, what do you do in this situation? Now here's the twist. What if this vicious battle was taking place within your own mind, within your brain? What if this vicious battle was taking place in your brain? Would that change the way you would now react? Probably. You may say, okay, where are you going with this? And here's where I'm going with this. The brain is the storehouse for two crucial compartments, the frontal lobe and the limbic system. You see, the frontal lobe is where the will is. the seat of reason. And the limbic system is where our drives are. The drive to sleep, the drive to eat, the drive to reproduce, the drive to react, to fight, to not to fight. All the drives, the impulses, come from the limbic system. And the Lord designed that our frontal lobe would be the head and that the limbic system would be the tail. There's nothing wrong with these drives. But after sin entered into the human race, the limbic system, the place where our drives come from, has been crowned king, and the frontal lobe has been made a slave. To the point to where we do things now without reasoning. This is why things happen. You say, well, why would somebody do that? I guess they wasn't thinking. Well, when your mind is functioning in a way to where it is a slave to the impulses of the carnal nature, then you're never going to reason from cause to effect. You see, our opening text was Romans 8:7. It says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. Enmity is bitter hatred. We have to recognize that naturally coming out of the womb, there's a bitter hatred towards God. Because the carnal mind is not subject to the law of God. Neither indeed can be. And simply put, the law of God is not, it's not only the Ten Commandments. It's the will of God. The will of God is summed up in the Ten Commandments, but the carnal mind is not subject to it. It's not willing to follow it. Why? Because after sin, mankind's will has been broken. Our will is bent. This is why you can have two treasure chests. One can be full of bottles and guns and knives, and the other one full of candy and balloons and toys. And the kid's going to be off in this box. We are bent towards evil because our will has been broken. And the magnitude of the frontal lobe being made a slave will be like an 8-year-old child running the house. Now, what reasonable parent would give an 8-year-old the checkbook and say, well, if you feel like paying the rent this month, you pay the rent. If you feel like we need to just run down to Disneyland and spend up all the money, that's what we're going to do. No reasonable parent would do that. But this is the predicament that we as humans are now in. Yet, the Lord is so good that he pledged his very own life to redeem us. With the expectation that we will come as we are, after making an agreement that we will let God take us to where we need to be. Yes, you can come as you are. You can come to God with a frontal lobe that is a slave to your limbic system, to where we just do whatever we want to do, when we want to do it, how we want to do it. Now, basically, creation is backwards. This is why the Lord says in Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be like scarlet. You see, this imagery of the Bible is saying, like, though your sins be permanent, I make them like they never was. Though they be red like crimson, I make them white as wool. And that happens only when we are educated to know good, truly know good from evil, and make the right decision. Yet, the carnal mind functions in reverse. Do what you want to do is the common thought throughout the land. Metaphorically speaking, a child is leading. But God, he can work with a child leading. He can work with a corrupt limbic system and bring it back. We see that in our first text, 2 Kings 22, verse 1.
Amen.
2 Kings 22, verse 1. God is showing that I can take a corrupt limbic system. I can take a child, and I can lead us into victory.
Amen.
2 Kings chapter 22, verse 1 says, Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign.
Yeah.
And he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Jediah, the daughter of Adaiah of Boscath. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the way of David his father, and turned not aside to the right hand nor to the left. I give this example to show that although we're born with a carnal mind, the Lord has made provisions for us to be overcomers. Never forget, sin is a choice. It's not something that you have to do, and it's not something that God would want you to do. It's a choice. But the key to understanding the power to overcome sin is understanding that the Lord has given us the power, and it's placed within the will. But I guess I would give this example. You think about like the Vietnam War. And all these times you would see like this helicopter come down and pick up the wounded soldiers. But those wounded soldiers, they had to get to a certain point. That helicopter wouldn't just come down anywhere. It was a specific point. And that's that. You can say the power of God is the helicopter, and the specific point where it's landed is your will. It's the will. So we have to ask the question, have we truly surrendered our will to God? You know, there's many people who have come to Jesus and been with Jesus for years, but never have surrendered the will, which is a non-negotiable exchange. In order to get Christ's righteousness, you have to get his will. You have to give over your will to God. Because sin has placed our will in the devil's hands. This is why we say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm not going to do that no more. And then we turn right back around and do the same thing over again. It's because the will is still bent towards the devil. It's the current. The will is like the current. I remember in 2012, me and my wife, we went down to Galveston on the beach. And they tell you, don't swim out too far. Because right now the current is going this way. But if you go too far out there, the current is going that way. And you're not going to swim against the current. So basically, that told me, if a person goes too far out there, they better be ready to swim to Mexico. Because you're not coming back this way. It's the current. The will has to be going in the current of God. And if it's going in the current of God, then we can understand when Paul says, the love of Christ constraineth me. Not restrained. The love of God doesn't stop me from doing evil. It compels me to do good. Constrained means it's a persuasion to come forward. It's not restrained. God is not restraining us from doing evil. He is propelling us to do good. Now, Josiah, he gave over his will to God. Key word, gave. He didn't let God borrow his will. He gave him his will. And as we go forward, keep in mind that when I speak about the flesh, I'm speaking about the limbic system. And when I speak about the frontal lobe, I'm speaking about the spirit, the mind, the part of the brain where the Holy Spirit seeks to place his throne. And you know, the Bible speaks about the heart and the mind a lot. And that heart, that limbic system, is desperately wicked. We see that in Jeremiah 17, verse 9. Jeremiah 17, verse 9, it describes the heart, the core of the limbic system, which says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Can we trust our feelings? No. Feelings are not reality. A person makes a lot of decisions when they're emotional, but that's not truly how they feel. This is what Jesus was saying in Matthew 26, verse 41. When he was going through the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter, James, and John are supposed to be there helping God by praying. And he's talking to the disciples, and particularly Peter, and he says, could you not stay up with me 1 hour? Watch and pray lest you fall into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. There's an inner battle going on. In Galatians 5, 16 through 18, Paul speaks about how the spirit, it wars against the flesh. They're clashing. It's a fierce battle. It's almost as if, like, every time we sin, we're chipping away at our own life. And God is trying to save us from destruction. 1 Peter 2:11 is saying the same thing. The spirit and the flesh are constantly waging. The frontal lobe, the reasoning center, your ability to know what is right and wrong versus what you want to do and when you want to do it. That leads us to Romans 7. Romans 7, verses 18 and 19. What we see here is Paul speaking about a man with two personalities, split personalities. We see this raging war of the limbic system versus the frontal lobe. Now, Paul says in Romans 7, 18 and 19, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me." I mean, he said, for to will is present with me. The desire to do good is present with me. But how to perform that which is good, I find not. Paul is saying, I'm seeking to live the Christian life. But I'm failing. Verse 19, "For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do." This is a man caught in a conundrum, caught in a trap. He wants out. This is like somebody who's in a gang. They want out the gang, but they can't get out with their life. Say, if you want out, we're going to kill you. This is a struggle. If you drop down to verse 22, Paul says, "For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity of the law of sin, which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death?" Paul says, I'm trapped. How am I going to overcome? The key is in the will. Victory hinges on the position of the will. This is a quote from the book Acts of the Apostles. "It's not a conclusive evidence that a man is a Christian because he manifests spiritual ecstasy under extraordinary circumstances." Meaning, we get into tough circumstances and we say, "Well, I'm going to go pray to God." That's not evidence that you're a Christian. Holiness is not rapture. It's not just an overwhelming feeling that just like, "Whoa, I just feel so good." It is an entire surrender of the will to God. It is living by every word that proceeds out the mouth of God. It is doing the will of our Heavenly Father. It is trusting God in trial, in darkness, as well as in the light. It is walking by faith and not by sight. It is relying on God with unquestioning confidence and resting in His love. Surrender of the will, the current of the life. Now, is the will and willpower the same thing? No, they're different. The will, giving God your will, is like voting somebody to be the governor of your life. And when you vote in a governor, you expect that person to bring about a change. But when it comes to willpower, that's you bringing about a change. And that's okay in some situations. But spiritually speaking, willpower is against us. We cannot save ourselves. Can the Ethiopian change his skin? Can the leopard change his spots? No. Can we who are accustomed to do evil do good? The Bible tells us we have to have a source of power outside of ourselves. Everything we do with a carnal mind turns into selfishness. With a carnal mind, we don't even raise our kids with good motives. You're only doing it because it's your kids. That's selfish. That's not agape love. Agape love is self-sacrificing love. We're not born with that type of love. It flows from the throne of God. And that's why it says in Isaiah 66, verses 6 through 8, but we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousness are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities are like the wind, have taken us away. And there is none to call upon thy name that stirreth upon himself to take hold of thee. For thou hast hid thy face from us and hast consumed us because of our iniquities. Our righteousness is as filthy rags because the motive of what we do is selfish by nature. It is selfish by nature. This is why the will must be given over to God. If the will is given over to God, then our righteousness is not a filthy rag. If it's Christ doing it for me, through me, it's not a filthy rag. Through me, it's not a filthy rag. You know, the carnal mind, it flows in the direction of selfishness at all times. That's why we must receive a new mind. But before the gospel seed can take root, what has to happen to the will? The will must be given over to God. Does God have full control, or are we still making decisions? The will is very crucial. We see Paul spoke about a helpless condition in Romans 7:18-19. But what does it look like when the will is winning the battle? We see that example in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. We see what happens when the carnal mind is winning. That which we want to do, we won't do. And that which we say we're not going to do, that's exactly what we do. But what happens when the will is given over to the Spirit? We see that in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. Actually, let me go ahead and start in verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds. Here's verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing it into captivity, every thought to the obedience of Christ. When we can bring every evil thought into captivity and every evil imagination, now the will is in control. The will is the master, and the limbic system is the slave. We don't just do what we want to do because we want to do it. We live off of every word that proceeds out the mouth of God. Because you can't trust feelings and emotions. Let me give you a prime example of how you can't trust feelings and emotions. In 1997, I was 12 years old. Myself, a gentleman who was 12 years old, and my brother, who was 14 at the time, we received police brutality. I watched them bend my brother's leg back in a way to they just wanted to inflict pain on him. I had long hair then, and I had my hair puffed out in like an afro. They pulled a patch out of my hair. I watched them DDT a 12-year-old boy on his head. How do you feel? Have I gained your sympathy? Well, here's the other half of that story. We were committing burglary. Yeah. That's how you can't trust the limbic system. And you can hear one side of the story, and you're like, man, just get them cops right now. Now, what they did was unjustifiably wrong. But the other half of that story is, how did I get into that situation? I had no business breaking into this building. So you cannot trust emotions. You can't trust just hearing one side, and then we jump on something. Because if we do, we jump it into the lap of the devil. Dangerous thing. Now, I want to bring all this together and give you a character example from someone from the Bible. I want to speak about a woman who had an interesting life. She struggled to get the victory over sin. Let's go to Luke chapter 7 and start with verse 36. Luke chapter 7, verse 36. Now I'm going to tie in everything we spoke about with the will, the current of the will, and the only way to place that will in God's hands is a true surrender of control. You see, there's some dangerous phrases. We as Christians use, we say stuff like, I don't care. Well, as soon as you say you don't care, your will has been placed in the devil's hands. Because Christians care. As soon as you say I don't care, you're saying I'm going off. I'm going off. They better not. Those type of statements place you in the will of the devil. Statements, when things are getting crucial and it's a hot, heated situation, how many times do you say, not my will, but thy will? That's what we need to say. Luke 7, 36 through 50. Verse 36. Let me start there. This is an interesting ordeal, but it ties everything together that we've been speaking about. Luke 7, verse 36. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat at the house of the Pharisees, or at the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Okay, you got a woman who she's struggling to get the victory. She hears Jesus is at this man's house, this Pharisee named Simon, and she goes and she takes this alabaster box. Let's say that alabaster box represents the will. She takes her will to Jesus, and she pours it all out. And that's a great thing, right? Well, let's see what happens in verse 39. Now when the Pharisee, which had bidden him, saw it, he spake within himself. Notice, he said this in his heart. He said this in his mind. He said it to himself. This man, if he were a prophet, he would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answered him, saying unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he said, Master, say on. You see, he wouldn't realize Jesus was reading his thoughts. Say on. What you got to say to me? Jesus gives him a parable. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors, the one which owed 500 pence and the other owed 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him the most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. He said unto him, thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? I entered into thy house, and thou gave me no water for my feet, but she washed my feet with her tears, and washed them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with her oil didst she anoint. But this woman hath anointed, or my head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Now, the current of Simon's life was exposed now. He talked high and holy, and he talked religiously, but now the current of his life has been exposed by the indwelling of Jesus in his house. This is symbolic of Revelation chapter 3, 19 through 22, as Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, if any man let me in." But what's going to happen if Jesus comes in? Revelation 19 says, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent." There's going to be some repenting and some rebuking. And yes, it's going to be joy as well. Now, he's let Jesus come into his house, and he's thinking that God is going to overlook the fact that he has not even given his will over to God. This man is just as much a sinner as this woman, but yet he's saying, this man, if he was a prophet, he would know what type of woman he was with. But now Jesus exposes him and shows him his folly. You see, the more we get closer to Jesus, the greater the feeling of unmerited worthiness will and should be. Did y'all catch that? The closer you get to Jesus, the less highly you're going to feel about yourself. And it should be that way. But here's the key thing. Never mistake conviction for condemnation. Sometimes we start getting closer to God, and then we say, well, I don't want to study this no more. I don't want to study with that person no more because I don't feel saved. Or I'm feeling convicted. And we push away from God. Like, oh, this can't be from God. I shouldn't feel like this. Yes, you should. Conviction is a good thing. It's God going further. Condemnation is not of God. God is not condemning you when he convicts you. That's the purpose of the law of God. It's like a metal detector that, instead of a metal detector, it's a sin detector. And we got sins on the floor of the oceans of our heart. And we're like, oh, I'm clean. And the law comes in and starts detecting stuff. And that pisses us off because no one wants to be confronted. And that's why the carnal mind is enmity against the law, the will of God. And it's not subject, neither indeed can be. It cannot be. You have to change the will. It's the only way. Now, going back to Luke 7, picking up in verse 48, it says, "And he said unto her, Thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, Who is this that forgiveth sins also? And he said to the woman, Thy faith has saved thee. Go in peace." You see, forgiveness is so much more than what we have grasped. We spoke a little bit about this in Sabbath school. You cannot, forgiveness and giving your will over to God, there is a crucial connection between the two. You cannot give your will over to God and serve God as the Christian you want to be until you have forgiven any and everyone. Forgiveness is very crucial. This is why we have people who, they want to live a Christian life. They do love God. As Paul says, to will is present with me. But how to do it, I know not. It's because they have unforgiveness in their heart. You see, forgiveness is much more than just simply saying, I ain't mad at you no more. No. It's actually, it's forgive. I'm giving you this in exchange for the grief you've caused me. Forgiveness is a supernatural act. And many have claimed to forgive someone. In reality, all they've done is turned their anger into self-righteousness. That's it. They have not truly forgave. All they have done is took their anger and turned it into self-righteousness and got their head up and like, yeah. Mm-hmm. But where's the forgiveness? And without that forgiveness, it's going to be hard to clearly understand the Bible. It's going to be hard to live out the Bible because the will is forever going to be in the grasp of Satan until we forgive. And this woman, she knew her sins was forgiven when she came to Jesus, and that's why she was able to give over her will to Jesus. And she walked away more than a conqueror. She exchanged Christ's righteousness for submission of her will and placed her will under Jesus. I end in Mark 14. Mark 14. Today I just wanted to spark the interest of the will and spark the interest of how you give it over to God. It starts with forgiveness. There shouldn't be anyone on this planet that we have a detested feeling towards. Mark 14, 3 through 9. This is the same situation, but looked at from a different aspect. Yeah, we've seen Simon the Pharisee. We see his reaction, but now this is the very action of the disciples along with Simon. Mark 14, starting in verse 3. And being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper. See, I mean, the man had leprosy. Jesus saved him, you know. But anyway, we want to be saved, but we hard on others. As he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious. And she broke the box and poured it on his head. And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? Now, we know that was Judas. For it might have been sold for more than 300 pence and had been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For you have the poor with you always, and wherever you will, you may do them good. But me you have not always. She hath done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint my body to the burial. You see, when Jesus was being buried, his body was not anointed. As the Sabbath was coming in, they just left his body. But he didn't need to be anointed because she had already anointed him. When you are in the will of God, you are living out prophecy. Verse 9. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. Mary got the victory, folks. She got the victory. And that's why everywhere the gospel is preached, we're supposed to be telling this story about a woman who struggled, but finally got the breakthrough that she was looking for through Jesus by giving her will over to Jesus. And if you and I want to give our will over to Jesus and actually live the Christian life that God expects and the life that we really want to live but fail to live, check your heart and see if you have unforgiveness in your heart. Because there is no such thing as a lazy Christian, an angry Christian, a greedy Christian, a selfish Christian. These are oxymorons. That's not Christian. So if we have these propensities within us, it just might be there's unforgiveness in us. Victory is sweet, and it can be yours. Luke 8:1, verse 1 through 2 says, and it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing glad tidings of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him. And a certain woman, which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary, called Magdalene, out of whom went 7 devils. That's a serious victory. That is a serious victory. And it can be yours. With that said, we'll come to the Lord in prayer that he and he alone can control our will and no longer the devil. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, meek and lowly. We are on an equal playing field, Lord. Even if Moses was with us right now, no one is better than anyone. We are all in need of a personal Savior, an individual Savior who will save us from a corrupt limbic system, Lord, that has us doing what we want to do at the cost of others' expense, at the cost of your son's expense. Father God, search me. Search us. See if there be any wicked way in us. See if there be some unforgiveness in us, Lord, that blocks us from being the true version of a Christian that this Bible says we should be. It is time to get victory, Lord. But you can't give us victory if we are chained by unforgiveness. We offer you our will, Lord. It ain't much. But yet you still want it. And you showed how much you value us in the death of your son. If we had price tags, the price tag would say the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Glorify your name in us. Happy Sabbath to you. And we bless your name. Amen.